91% of new renewable energy projects are now cheaper than fossil fuel-based alternatives. That is the claim that's being made by the International Renewable Energy Agency as published on the 22nd of July, 2025. We're going to examine that more closely in today's episode of Climate Mundial's Energy and Climate Weekly. So let's get right into that. The claim that renewable energy projects are cheaper than fossil fuel-based alternatives is largely based around the levelized cost of energy. That is, it's a formula that includes the capital costs as well as the operating costs. And when we say operating costs, we also include the costs of capital, that is the equity and debt that's needed to finance a project, as well as ongoing fuel requirements and so forth, which for renewable energy projects is effectively quite low, if not zero, in particular with things like solar and wind. So the levelized cost is used as the basis to compare the overall cost per megawatt hour of a renewable energy project as compared to a fossil fuel-based alternative on the assumption that the project is not yet built, and so everything associated with the capital cost of the project still needs to be incurred. So the levelized cost is really important as a concept to understand and digest these claims that renewable energy is cheaper than fossil fuel-based alternatives. Now, the initial reaction to such a claim is that, well, if renewable energy is cheaper than fossil fuel-based alternatives, then surely now this is fantastic. The business as usual scenario would be that renewables are going to outcompete fossil fuel-based developments. And therefore, from a climate perspective, we're in a very good position. Now, let's remember also that globally, if we look at 2022, which is the most recent year when we have data available globally, there were around 50.1 billion tons of greenhouse gas emissions across all countries in the world. And roughly 6.5 to 6.8 billion tons of that amount, so nearly one third of all those emissions, result from electricity generation and heat. So that's a really important group of emissions. However, the cost comparisons that are being done on the basis of levelized cost assumes that it's a new build situation. So we have a greenfield scenario where we need to evaluate which project is more economic, assuming that nothing has already been built, when in actual fact, we know that these 16.8 billion tons of emissions are occurring in fossil fuel-based projects which are already built and operational. So from a purely climate perspective, the fact that renewable energy is cheaper for new build situations is, I mean, it's very important and it's wonderful. However, it doesn't deal with the emissions that are already occurring in the fossil fuel-based sectors. So it's a really important thing to note the difference between levelized cost and new projects versus the emissions that are occurring on a yearly basis as we speak and contributing to very large proportions of global emissions that are coming from fossil fuel-based electricity generation. This issue has effectively been validated quite recently by Verra, which is a voluntary carbon market certification body, which has actually done two things which are really important. One is it's introduced a new methodology that allows the retirement of existing fossil fuel-based plants to generate carbon certificates. So basically, the action of retiring a fossil fuel or coal-fired power plant that's replaced then by cleaner generation can actually have its emission reductions certified. And that provides an incentive to fast track, if you like, the retirement of some carbon intensive forms of generation. So that's one really important initiative. The second is that Verra is also opening up a consultation about the inclusion of grid-connected renewable energy in a whole range of different developing countries and emerging markets. And this is on the recognition of exactly the point that was made before, which is that, sure, in a new build situation, there may be a cost advantage in a lot of cases for renewables. But the real climate task here is to introduce more renewables or lower emission sources of generation that can actually outcompete and replace the fossil fuel-based generation that's already in the system. And the amount of emissions that are coming from this sector alone are very, very significant. So there has been a recognition from Verra, and of course there are other certification bodies around the world that are looking at this issue as well. There's other forms of climate finance that's available for renewable energy projects. But this is very important because it recognizes this issue that something needs to be done, some incentives need to be provided in order to see this transition from fossil fuel-based generation towards renewable generation on existing plants, operating models, and also existing grids. And if we look around the world, we do actually see that a number of governments still provide incentives and subsidies to renewable energy generation, which is an implicit acknowledgement that more work is needing to be done to introduce renewables and allow those renewables to displace fossil fuel-fired generation in electricity grids. If we look at some countries like, for example, Australia is using a renewable energy certificate program, which is very important. If we look to the United Kingdom, there's the use of a contract for difference program to incentivize renewables who get the advantage of a long-term contract for difference hedging mechanism to ensure that the investments are viable. And there are different initiatives, for example, being used in Italy, not only to incentivize new generation and renewables, which is working quite well, but Italy is particularly focused on this issue of decoupling the price of generating electricity from renewables in the wholesale market from the price of generation from fossil fuel sources, which is basically a problem because of the issue that I mentioned before, which is that in order to have higher levels of penetration of renewables in given electricity grids and networks, there is a degree of reliance on fast start generation, like gas-fired generation, to actually provide this backup generation and ensure that there's reliability across these electricity systems. Notwithstanding all of the enthusiasm towards decarbonisation of electricity networks, one does still need to be cognizant of the investments that have been made previously in fossil fuel-based generation. And another really important consideration is reliability. To what extent do additional renewable projects entering the grid represent a problem in relation to scheduling generation and making sure that electricity is available on networks when consumers need it? And that's why it's very important to realize that there's still a role for things like gas-fired generation to make sure that there is reliable supply of electricity. Of course, we're seeing the development of storage technologies and so forth, BESS projects as they're sometimes referred to, but there's still a lot of work to go. So it's important that as we push ahead with renewable solutions, we don't lose sight of the fact that reliability and cost effectiveness and investments previously made are all very, very important priorities as we move forward. So to summarize, this is very encouraging news that 91% of renewable energy generation projects are more viable than fossil fuel-based alternatives. So that is fantastic, and we should all be very pleased about that. However, we should also be under no illusions about the task at hand. Still, we're seeing as many as 16.8 billion tons of emissions globally, so nearly 30% of global emissions, which are resulting from the generation of electricity and heat around the world. So there's further work that needs to be done to incentivize renewables in a context where there is still a lot of decarbonization work that needs to take place. But what do you think about renewables? Do you think they require market-based incentives, or do you think there's some case still for subsidization by government? Please let me know what you think by making a comment below. If you like this video, please click like. If you haven't already subscribed, please do so. And be sure to share the video with your colleagues, family, and friends, because that's a really good way for you to support the channel. And it will also help me to understand what topics are of interest for future videos. But in the meantime, I'd like to say thank you very much for your attention. And I look forward to seeing you again soon in the next episode of Climate Mundial's Energy and Climate Weekly. Bye for now.